Hey, yeah, so welcome to our talk on the development of reactive systems with Ember.js. And the goal of the talk is nothing less than to revolutionize the way that you think about application architecture with Ember. For everybody who's waiting for code samples, please don't be sad. There won't be code samples in the talk, but everything that we tell you can result in executable code. But this is not the main focus of this talk. The focus of this talk is the mental model, but rest assured, you can actually use this directly in your code. And the end of the talk will include some links that point you into the right direction. Also, Clemens and I are super excited about the concept that we're going to present. So always feel free to just ping us on Twitter, ping us on Discord, or shoot us an email. We're super happy to and excited to help you out with this concept. Who are we and why should you care what we have to say? I'm Michael and my co-presenter is called Clemens. You can find us on the internet via our handle LevelBossMike, and we've been doing Ember.js development for basically since Ember was a thing. We philosophize over Ember a lot, and quite honestly, we can't remember who started out. We didn't know each other back then, but yeah, we basically have been using Ember since it was a thing, and before that, we were interested in SpotCore. Because we have so much experience building apps with Ember.js, we also run an Ember.js consultancy called Effective Ember, where we can help you and your team build with Ember. Even if you're not interested in getting help from a consultancy, you might also be interested just looking at our homepage, because there's a blog and there might be some interesting topics discussed there as well. To keep things moving forward, before actually telling you about the concept, that the reactive systems concept, I think it makes sense to actually start from the beginning and explain to you our journey, how we came to this concept, right? Although we have had a lot of experience with Ember.js, working with Ember.js before and implementing a lot of applications with it, sometimes with client-side development, although we are using the best framework, which we are still confident that Ember is the best framework, we have some experience with other frameworks as well, but in our experience, things just get more complicated if you don't use Ember, right? So although we had so much experience, oftentimes we ended up in situations where stuff just felt hard, right? Client-side application development felt hard to us at some points, especially if you're doing some more intricate stuff like offline data or collaborative editors, stuff like that. But even then, if you're not implementing stuff like that, and even if you're only just dealing with some stuff like dropdowns, custom dropdowns or type ahead components, stuff like that, you oftentimes end up in situations where things get complicated quickly, and we couldn't really tell why that was the case. So we started thinking about that more thoroughly. And if you think about from an architecture perspective, Ember.js, on top of its convention that it gives you, Ember CLI, the add-on ecosystem, and also the ideas that it has about routing, it really doesn't provide developers with too much guidance about your application architecture, right? The only paradigm that you tend to hear a lot and what you always tell people when they ask you how to build stuff, and we always tell them, hey, yeah, just use data down actions up, right? Because that's basically the only architecture paradigm that we have. And the idea can be summed up pretty simply. So in data down actions up, you have some kind of application state, whatever that may mean, and you pass down that data or state into the template layer, and the Glimmer rendering virtual machine then takes care of rendering the template for you and basically spits out some HTML that combines the data that you pass down and the template that you created. And then whenever you want to change something in your application, or you want to enable users to change something, you send an action up, right? Doesn't really matter how to do that, because back in the days we really had action bubbling, but in the end, nowadays it's a little bit different because we really pass down action handlers and call them directly. But in essence, you pass an action up and then some action handler does something and updates the state. We can't really tell you where this originated from, but we have an idea that this originated originally in the React ecosystem, or at least that's what we heard back in the day when this pattern was introduced into the ecosystem. Before that, we had two-way data bindings and observers, and this was obviously a better solution for a sane data than the two-way data bindings and observers. And this was like it was introduced to the ecosystem. It's like, yeah, this is what the React people are doing. React people are doing. It's working much better than what we're doing. So basically, let's switch to that. And that's fine and all, but that's fine. And it's nice for data flow. And if you take that to the extreme, basically consider your entire application. And with that paradigm, you end up with the idea of your application being a black box, right? That takes in the state input and then transforms it in some kind of form, and then it spits out an HTML representation, which is basically your UI app that you want to present to your users. And if you think about it, that's pretty much a back-endy view of the world, right? It's not that different to what we're doing with server-side rendering. We are just using inputs, transforming them in a black box, and then spitting out outputs, which in our case is an HTML representation that gets rendered in the browser. The nice thing about this paradigm is that it makes you sound super smart when you talk about it. And it sounds very, very elegant, right? It's basically your application is a function over the state that you want to show to your users, and the result of that is your UI. Unfortunately, when Clemens and I were discussing this, we realized that this sounds super cool, and it works if you think about presentational components, but it doesn't really address the complexity that is client-side development, right? Because if you think about it, the complexity when developing Image.js applications really doesn't lie in the passing down data to some kind of template layer and then having the Glimmer VM re-render for you, because Glimmer does that for you automatically. And also the complexity doesn't really lie in hooking up event listeners and then firing actions when somebody does something in your application, like clicking a button. The actual complexity lies in the squiggly part over there, not a straight arrow like we had before, but really the squiggly part where you actually need to do something in the action handlers, right? And that's the complex part. At some point, you actually need to do things and you actually want to update the state. But updating the state isn't really trivial, because in client-side application development, just so many things can happen at the same time, right? Francesco presented this idea of resource to us earlier, and this is a nice idea. So basically, yes, you could create a more solid architecture where you create these resources, and then these resources take care of updating stuff for you, or you just pull stuff out into classes and these things then update. But the actual complexity of just figuring out what needs to be done and what is happening at this current place in time isn't trivial. And this is the typical stuff that you see even with the most simplest things, like an async button component that triggers an async request when pressed. But you actually need to manually keep track of the fact that, hey, the user actually has clicked the button already, and we don't want to trigger the same async request while a request is already in flight. Or you actually might want to do that. And yeah, it's your job as the application developer to keep track of that. And that just gets overwhelming very, very quickly. The thing is that data down actions up really is a nice pattern, right? It sounds cool. And especially the React people, the React ecosystem basically tells you, hey, there's no issue here. Really need to embrace this pattern, because your UI is the state, the UI is the result of a function over state in time, right? This is literally what React is telling you. And basically what most people tend to tell you is that, yeah, somehow this works. And this is not particular hard to do with Ember or React or Svelte or Vue. It's all the same with all client-side frameworks. All of the client frameworks have embraced this pattern, right? Passing the state down and then triggering actions up when you want to change the state. So this is a nice view and elegant view, but does it really work, right? This is also a popular opinion if you ask people about, or basically just tell people, hey, I'm a client-side developer. Things are hard. I'm not entirely sure why. Do you have an idea? And the stuff that people tend to tell you, especially backend developers, are like, yeah, no, it's really this transformational thing. You just need to do that over and over again. You need to be able to render all the time. And it's just hard for you because the client-side developers aren't that bright. The real programming happens in the backend layer, and we basically don't know what you're complaining about. It's really not that hard. Client-side developers might just be not bright enough to solve this issue. Clemens and I thought about that a little bit, and we didn't feel like the Ember.js ecosystem was super stupid or we were super stupid. So we tried to look into the literature and basically tried to find out if anybody had encountered this issue before and might have proposed some solutions to this, right? And we were lucky. While skimming through the literature, we found this paper. And this paper is called On the Development of Reactive Systems. And because it has reactive in the name, we got quite curious, right? Reactivity is all the things that you hear when discussing client-side development. So that sounded relevant to our interest. Reading through this paper, the situation that the author, David Harrell, describes back in 1985 really sounded familiar to us, right? David Harrell described in this paper describes the fact that he feels like there are really two types of different systems. And one of them is much, much harder to implement than the other one. And the two types of systems that he's talking about is A, transformational systems, and reactive systems. Transformational systems, we already saw that's basically this F over state equals your UI portion. And then he goes on and discusses what he feels like is a reactive system, right? And this sounds very, very familiar if you come from the client side. He defines a reactive system as some kind of state system is stateful, right? It has state in itself. And then it continuously needs to react to internal and external events. So if you're a front-end developer, this sounds very, very familiar to you. And Harrell argues that in contrast to the transformational systems, A, these are much, much reactive systems are much, much harder to implement. And B, they need to be modeled totally differently. Plus, you actually have to have a completely different, they're just a different set of system, right? So in contrast to a transformational systems where you only have inputs and this black box that converts that to outputs, you actually have a stateful system that basically needs to react to external and internal stimuli all the time. Also, this kind of system needs to be able to respond to interrupts, like high priority events. For example, if you're a client-side developer, you might have run into situations where the user did something in your application. They tried to submit a form, but now they are navigating away completely and you want to cancel the request or something like that, right? So you need to be able to respond to interrupts. Also, the state of the system represents some kind of current mode that you're in. And this mode depends heavily on the stuff that happened on operations that you did that occurred before the current time, state and time, right? Also, a lot of things can happen in parallel. So again, we read that and we felt like, yeah, okay, this is definitely what a client system is. We read on because the nice thing about this is that with that idea of a reactive system, you can actually now upgrade your architecture idea of data down, actions up. You now finally have an idea of why things are so complicated and they feel much more complicated than what tend to tell you when they talk about this transformational system that you're apparently building, right? The image that you see on the screen now is basically our new idea of the world, where we're like, yeah, okay, we're dealing with a reactive system and this is where the complexity actually lives, right? So we actually need to find out how to model and how to build this reactive system now, what patterns exist on how we can deal with the fact that we're dealing with a reactive system. And lucky enough for us, Harrell proposes a solution to that in his paper, and he states that, and this is pretty huge takeaway from the talk today, he states that a reactive system is a totally different kind of system and it needs to be modeled differently. And a practicable way to model these types of systems is to do that based on states, events that occur in the system, and transitions that happen based on the events that occur in the system, and also side effects that can be triggered while transitions between states happen. He also argues that, which the React people are always telling us, that might be something that React people would tell you then if you talk to them about reactive systems, is that, hey, mathematically speaking, a reactive system is just something that acts like a transformational system, but it needs to be modeled as a transformational system with a second input as the current time, right? So basically, this is the continuous, we need to be able to re-render all the time idea that React proposes. Interestingly enough, in the paper from 1985, Harrell states that, yes, you mathematically speaking, you could argue to do this, but in practice, it's just impracticable and prone to failure because it just gets too complicated. And a much, much better idea to model these kinds of systems, as I said, based on states, events that happen in the system, transition between states that happen based on the events that occur in the system, and side effects that are triggered on state transitions. This is very cool because now we can, and I'm sorry, I need to go back a little bit. And the thing that you see on the screen here is called a visual language that Harrell also comes up with on how you can actually visualize the state transitions and events pattern. And the thing that on the screen is called a state chart, right? It's really not too hard to understand if you already know state machines, but it's more practical to work with because state charts, in contrast to state machines, actually support the idea of nesting parallel states and orthogonality in general. So they're much, much easier to work with than state machines. So the idea is to actually model your reactive system or how your reactive system should behave beforehand, right? And basically move all the complexity into the model of your reactive system instead of having to keep track of all the complexity yourself inside of these action handlers that you call. So our architecture idea of an Ember.js application transitioned quite a bit, and it has transitioned to this. So at the top of over everything, there's this idea of the reactive system that we model explicitly. And this reactive system has state that we pass down into the template layer. Glimmer takes care of rendering the state. And then whenever something needs to happen, we just send an event to the model that we created before explicitly. And this model takes care of figuring out what needs to happen next and if a state change should occur. We don't propose to, which might be important here, we don't propose to think of your entire Ember application as this one thing that you model explicitly in this super huge state chart. But Harrell explicitly states that a reactive system is made up of other nested reactive systems, right? And if you're if you're dealing with front-end applications, these smaller reactive systems, you can consider components, smaller reactive systems that in the sum of all things make up your reactive system, in addition to the actual application behavior that you want to model. This is a nice idea now, right? So we can actually just send events to the reactive system and the reactive system figures out what to do next. But why is this now so revolutionary and why does it make it so much easier to model complex behavior? And the reason for that is that it doesn't really matter what things occur in your system. Everything can be treated as an event, right? Things like a WebSocket event arriving or Navigator online changed event happening. It's really not, you really don't have to think about how to handle that anymore. You just model that explicitly and send the specific event to the model of the system, and the system reacts automatically. So the only thing that you have to do is basically model the system and then send events to it based on what in the UI from the internal or external stimuli. So that's got much, much easier, and it basically gets rid of the entire complexity of front-end development, especially if you're dealing with behavior, right? I really said it gets rid of the complete complexity and it just makes everything easy, basically. So you might get the idea that, hey, if that was so great and if that has been introduced 35 years ago, if everything worked great with that, why isn't everybody using that? Why did nobody care about thinking that this might be a good solution for client-side application development? To explain that in more detail, I want to give it over to Clemens, because he has thought about that more thoroughly than I did.
Michael basically was saying is that we are proposing a way to solve the inherent complexity we're dealing with in the front end. If this is such a groundbreaking way of thinking, how come this isn't used more widely in the UI development? How come this isn't talked about more? Is this maybe over-engineering, or is treating it as a reactive system making it more complex than it needs to be? Isn't all this relevant for embedded systems and maybe rocket science only? It turns out we're not the first one to propose this approach for front-end development. This has already been discussed 22 years ago in a book with the promising title Constructing the User Interface with State Charts by Ian Horrocks. In his book, Ian Horrocks proposes a methodological approach for developing user interfaces by using the toolset Michael was talking about in the first half of the presentation. So what we are doing basically is only to repeat what somebody said 22 years ago, who repeats what somebody said 38 years ago. We're merely standing on the shoulder of giants. And by the way, this book is very difficult to get. So if you have a chance to get a physical copy of it, you should buy it. It's well worth the investment. So we're now at the point where an argument for reactive systems has been made and a way to describe them via state charts. This has been introduced. At this stage, we always hear the same concerns. The most common response is that it's too complex and adds unnecessary complexity. A state chart describing a relatively small problem or even a supposedly simple form abstraction can look intimidatingly complex. Our argument is that the state charts only make the implicit complexity of your system explicit. And just because you don't want to see how complex your app is and how its behavior is, doesn't mean the complexity isn't there. Also, we're dealing with reactive systems, remember? That's what we've learned, and they are inherently more complex than transformational ones. Another concern we hear is that folks don't want to code, and but they want to code and not draw diagrams. And to us, this is an issue of development being only a part of engineering. Thinking about the system before it is coded helps with understanding of such a system and getting a better answer to the question of what it is we're actually building. Also, as Michael pointed out in the beginning, you can use state charts programmatically. So a state chart describing the behavior can be used directly in code, but this is not the scope of this talk, but yeah, we'll get into this at the end of this talk and talk about it a bit more. Another concern we're hearing is that not another tool. And we say that thinking of the application as a reactive system and describing it with state charts is not another tool. It's a correct mindset on how to think about the problem you're solving. And even if state charts aren't used in code, again, thinking about the system and describing it using the correct modeling language already helps with identifying edge cases. A prime example for this would be the question of, hey, what actually happens when an error is happening in this state right here? And a state chart makes obvious if transitions, for example, are missing. And this brings us to the last concern, which says that bottom-up approach is fine. So this is kind of analog to the point above about wanting to code and not draw diagrams. Coming up with code, describing the behavior in an ad hoc way is riddled with bugs and hard to maintain and often breaking in mysterious, hard to track down ways. Having the behavior expressed visually is a much better way to understand what's going on. And within, if the behaviors sprinkle around in code, it's much more difficult to reason about. So a visual representation trumps a textual one. A state chart says more than 1,000 lines of code. All right, so to recap, we talked about front-end applications being reactive system and state charts as a way to model them. Everything was quite theoretical for now, so this is an Ember meetup. Let's talk about how this is used in Ember applications. We told you that most complex apps can be modeled with this approach. One of the most complex apps we know in the Ember ecosystem will be talked in the next slide. it's a complex app because it's not so trivial to implement such an app in the Ember framework. So Alex Metchnier, as you might know, he asked the question of how a certain type of application would be developed using Ember.js. The blog post is called Ember Rideshare. And as you can see, it's from 2017, so 4 years later, but it's still an open issue. So let's take a look. For the uninitiated who don't remember exactly what that 4-year-old blog post was about, so the blog post basically talks about an application similar to Uber or Lyft, where a user logs in, the location of the user is determined, then a map is shown with nearby drivers, the user requests a ride, is awaiting for that the ride is assigned a driver, then he awaits the pickup, eventually gets pickup, arrives at the destination, and yeah, basically that's the flow of the app. And what Alex outlines in his post is basically 3 issues, which I'm going to summarize on the next slide. So the first one being stacked routing or navigation stack. So basically this means that such an app would have a stack where screens or frames are popped on and pushed off from this stack. This pattern is seen mostly in mobile user interfaces, and he argues that such a pattern is hard to realize with vanilla Ember using the conventional router infrastructure, especially if you want to persist that stack, and getting back later. The second issue raises is that URLs are not so first class. So Alex argues that only about 20% of such a rideshare application would be accessible. So only about 20% of a page of the pages of the rideshare application would be accessible at any given time, depending on which state the app is in. So in the example of Ember Rideshare, the user can't be in the request a new ride route when a ride is currently active. And the question is where to put such an can I be in this route logic without having duplication sprinkle around in various before model hooks or whatever or however it is solved. And this gets even more complicated when the server can send updates which need to be handled locally as well. And this brings us to the last issue mentioned in the blog post being the server-side state changes. So it's easy for front-end applications to consider the user as the sole originator of state changes, but there can be state changes which are not bound to actions made by the user, but instead are coming from the API. So an example of Ember Rideshare, we might need to navigate away from the driver's detail view when the driver became unavailable. Or we might need to show the next route when the rider arrived, and this is depending on where the user is currently at the moment, and the blog post calls for solutions for what Alex calls so-called server-side driven apps, and we propose that considering it as what it is, namely a reactive system, this helps modeling and solving the race problem. Let's ignore the stacked routing for now and only focus on the 2 main issues about the URL and the server-side changes. The issue basically is that the routing hierarchy and the URL define what is rendered, but don't offer enough flexibility. A state change or an event doesn't originate from the address bar or the click of a user. So if you think about the Ember Rideshare example as a reactive system, you can describe it on the high level as being in 2 states. So in the first state, the user is unauthenticated, then he logs in, then he's in the authenticated state, and then he can log out. When we kind of zoom in into the authenticated state, this can be refined into basically initially the user, or we are in a state of geolocating, so basically getting the location of the user. Once that happens successfully, we are in the state of showing the map, for example. And if the locationing fails for whatever reason, we are in a dedicated error state. Once we got the location, we are in the state where we show the map, and this can be further refined to the following. So initially we are ready, then the user requests a ride, and then we are basically in the request ride state. In this state, what can happen is basically, for example, that no driver is found, so we go back to the ready state. If we are requesting a ride and a rider has been assigned, then we go into the next state, which is basically awaiting the pickup. In this state, for example, the driver, which was already assigned, could have canceled. So we go back to the ready state. Or the user might decide to, I want to cancel the ride. So he wants to cancel it. Because we want to confirm the cancellation by the user, we are in a dedicated state. Let's call it cancel ride, which the user can abort and we're back at the waiting, or abort, really cancel, and we are back at ready. And in the happy path, when the user was awaiting the pickup and he gets picked up, we are in the riding state. And after we arrive, we finished it, can show a summary, and then we can go back to the ready. So we can zoom out again and see a whole behavior of the rideshare application. This diagram is easy to understand. It basically just puts the textual description of the rideshare app into states and adds events between them. It might seem a bit convoluted, but the rideshare app apparently has some complexity. And with that, we're basically done describing the behavior of the rideshare system. As we said before, so we don't include the code samples, since this talk is mainly about the mental model itself, but you can use the diagram and translate it into executable code. We plan to implement this as a case study with accompanying blog posts, which go into greater detail. But yes, it's not topic for this talk. So let's circle back to the stated problems of Amber Rideshare. So since we model the application as a reactive system, all state changes are solely handled by explicit events. The URL is not a central piece anymore around which the current state is defined. It's basically only a byproduct and serves as an entry point, telling the system basically, dear reactive system, please go into this state if you can. And if the event is not handled in this state, the event is simply ignored. Also, since everything is event-based, it doesn't matter where the events are coming from. This means the server-side state changes are a no-brainer. And it's basically as simple as forwarding the corresponding event to the system and letting it decide on how to handle it and what state change might occur. So we have seen that when we treat the rideshare example as a reactive system, the problems are going away because we are using a different way to model the system. And this basically concludes the talk on the topic of developing reactive systems with Amber.js. So let's do a final recap. So in the beginning, we argued that the complexity of front-end applications is inherent because we are dealing with reactive systems. We also showed that the state charts are a way to describe such systems. In other industries like embedded systems or at NASA, they use state charts all the time. It seems that we are the only ones who build reactive systems but don't model them as such. Now, if this talk has piqued your interest, your next question might be where to go from here. So we highly recommend reading through the paper on the reactive systems. You won't be surprised anymore of how familiar the concepts stated in there are to us front-end developers. Also, the stage up paper goes in a much greater detail of the overview and the formalism and characteristics of the state charts. And it explains it in a very approachable way. Even just using the state charts as a tool to think about your system is already helpful. And once we got hooked, we certainly can't imagine engineering apps without them anymore. If you want to know more how to use state charts within your Amber application, go check out the amberstatecharts.com. homepage, which is basically the documentation for the add-on we've said in the beginning. And so basically, this add-on allows you to use your visual stage chart configuration in code, so you can use that described behavior. On amberstagecharts.com, there's a long tutorial and an introduction of how stage charts can be used within Amber applications. So we presented our thinking for this paradigm for the first time in such a way to a bigger Amber audience. And this is exciting, and we're looking forward to the discussion. I want to close with this final statement. If you only take one thing away from this presentation, it should be this. You're building a reactive system. You can ignore that fact, but we can tell you from our experience that if you embrace it, you will have a much easier time building complex systems.